Absolute Radio. And tonight, my guest down in the staff canteen is Tim Minchin. Let's hear it for Tim.
Thank you.
You sound a little like Michael Jackson there with the timid thank yous.
Thank you. Oh, I'm just so modest.
It's a beautiful thing to see. Now, thank you so much for coming in because you're poorly sick. You're not well at all.
I'm a little crook, as we say, down where I come
crook.
From. Crook? Yeah, crook. Crook. Crook in the guts. No, I'm just snotty. It's nice radio, isn't it?
Well, you know, maybe you could just breathe through your nostril into the microphone to prove it.
No, they don't need to hear that. Someone will sample it and turn it into a hip-hop song.
I'm down.
Mention snot.
Yeah. So how long have you been coming down with this for?
I got back from Australia a week and a half ago and inevitably my children acquired some plain-born flu coldy thing and then festered with it in their horrible little disease-ridden bodies and then spat it all over me over breakfast one morning and, you know, I, like a good father, took it on board.
It's a shame you can't time your tours for when your kids are ill.
Yeah, actually, I think it is incredible how you manage to be well, to get on stage. I mean, I get sick as much as anyone with two little kids, which is quite often, but it's incredible how your body, the adrenaline or whatever it is, just by Saturday night when I have to be on stage again, I'll be better. And I was basically sick for a month between the end of my December tour and the start of my Australian tour, so, you know, that's how it goes. I get my diseases all done in between the gigs.
Well, that's very professional of you.
Thank you, yeah. Do it for the fans, mate. Yeah.
So speaking of which, we're in the staff canteen and there's a few people close up in here. Is this unusual for you these days to be in front of such a small crowd?
Yeah, I think it's a security risk. incredibly insecure.
Is it scary seeing the whites of their eyes?
Yeah. There's a few people I recognise from stage doors. It is a thing about touring arenas and stuff, is this sense of disconnect and you logistically you can't really go to stage door and meet people because you'd be there all night and you lose your voice and all that sort of boring stuff. And it all becomes this massive machine and it's great and we've worked really hard to create a show that fills arenas and all that sort of thing, but you do lose the audience a bit, your relationship with them while you're performing and in your life. But interestingly for me, I'm in the US a bit this year and I'm doing 200 seaters with just a piano and a couple of parkans, you know, and it's really great to do that at the same time.
You get a bit of everything.
They're both fun. Yeah.
Have you ever played dinner piano? Dinner jazz.
Oh yeah, I played in piano bars for I didn't start doing comedy till 29 and up until 7 years ago I was still playing in keyboards. This very keyboard that I've got here, I was lugging it out of my studio today. You might have noticed that I don't sort of play keyboards
anymore.
It's part of my act is this sort of the ostentation of the instrument and I have become a total piano snob. Yeah. But this thing I've put in the back of my Holden station wagon hundreds of times and carried it through drunken hordes at pubs to play keyboards and cover bands and stuff. But I also did quite a lot of sort of lounge piano playing your Elton Johns and stuff to people who'd be smoking and turn to me to blow the smoke into my face in order to save their friends from the displeasure.
Did you ever, like just as an act of rebellion, slip in anything a bit contrary into your set in those places?
Well, the place that I played cocktail piano most. I mean, I'm not a jazz pianist, so I was sort of bluffing through the jazz standards and stuff. But later in the night, I started putting some of my own songs in, and they, at that stage, weren't quite as deliberately obtuse. They were just quirky. I always wrote quirky songs before they became just sweary and vitriolic. And I actually started dragging an audience. So by the time I finished playing there, people come on Wednesday night to see me do my songs. So, and actually, it was one of the things that kind of threw me in this direction eventually.
Well, you've mentioned that you've got your old trusty keyboard. How would you feel about taking to the plastic chair behind the keyboard?
Yeah, I'll take to my trusty.
Right, well, please welcome in session tonight, Tim Minchin.
This is a song about prejudice. It's called Prejudice. In our modern free-spoken society, there is a word that we still hold taboo,
taboo.
A word with a terrible history of being used to abuse, oppress and subdue. Just six seemingly harmless letters arranged in a way that will form a word with more power than the pieces of metal that are forged to make swords. A couple of G's, an R and an E, an I and an N. Just six little letters all jumbled together have caused damage that we may never mend. And it's important that we all respect that if these people should happen to choose to reclaim the word as their own, it doesn't mean the rest of you have a right to its use. So never underestimate the power that language imparts. Sticks and stones may break your bones, but words can break hearts. A couple of G's, G's, unless you've had to live it. An R and an E, even I am careful with it. An I and an N, in the end it'll only offend. Don't wanna have to spell it out again. Yeah. Yeah. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. So listen to me, if you care for your health, you won't call me ginger unless you ginger yourself. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. When you are a ginger, life is pretty hard. Years of ritual bullying in the schoolyard. Kids calling you ranger and fanta pants. No invitation to the high school dance. But you get up and learn to hold your head up. You try to keep you cool and not get fed up. But until the feeling of ill is truly let up, then the word is ours and ours alone. Don't you know that only a ginger can call another ginger ginger? So if you call us ginge, we just might come unhinged. If you don't have a fringe with at least a tinge of the ginge in it. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. Now listen to me, we're not looking for sympathy. Just because we're sensitive to UV. Just because we're pathetically pale. We do a right with the females. Yeah, I like to ask the ladies round for ginger beer. And soon they're running their fingers through my ginger beard. And dunking my ginger nuts into their ginger tea, yeah. And asking, can they call me ginger? And I say, I don't think that's appropriate. Cause only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. And all the ladies, they agree, it's a fact. Once you're gone, ginger can't go back. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. Yeah, go you funky mofo. You can call us bozo or fire truck. You can even call us carrot top or blood nut. Yeah, you can call us matchstick or tampon. But screwing with the G word is just not on. If you're a gingerphobe and you don't like us, we will stand up to the fight if you want to fight us. But if you cut yourself, you might catch gingivitis. So maybe you should shut your funky mouth. Yeah, only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. So if you call us ginge, you can't whinge if you're injured. If you don't have a tinge, the ginge in your minge. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. And you know my kids will always be clothed and fed, cause Papa's gonna be bringing home the gingerbread. And they'll be pretty smart because they'll be well read. And by red I mean red and the other kind of red. It's a homophone, woo! Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. Only a ginger can call another ginger ginger. Just like only a ninja can sneak up on another ninja. Oh, only a ginger, only a ginger, only a ginger, yeah. Are you listening? I'm not pointing the finger, I'm just having a singer. I am just reminding ya. that only a ginger can call another ginger, ginger.
I never thought I'd get to feel how an African-American would feel hearing Dr. King speak.
Yeah. Yet, did you well up? Did you tear up behind your frames?
Yeah, I really did. That was a beautiful thing.
Thanks.
Now, I see that you're wearing Jesus around your neck today.
No, that's me.
Sorry, my mistake.
That's me. I want to produce a bunch of crosses. I have a bit in my show about being a fan of intersections. I thought it'd be good to have a bunch of crosses with just I heart intersections written on them. Or I heart lowercase letter T.
Yeah, it could be a money spinner. You've talked about some of these beautiful people waiting for you at the stage door after gigs. Mm-hmm. Do you ever get religious nutters?
Strangely, no. I don't seem to attract those people.
So I wondered, when they did Jerry Springer, the opera, for example, a few years ago, there was quite a sort of uprising against it.
Or Jesus Christ Superstar in the 70s. There's definitely a grand tradition of people with apparently incredibly loving faith systems trying to bring down other people's art. But I think a lot of what makes people angry is the apparent state sanctioning of this work. Jerry Springer, the opera, is shown on BBC and stuff. But also, just like the cartoons of Muhammad and all that sort of stuff, it just depends what some fanatic decides to go at. And some dude decided to go at Jerry Springer, and most of the complaints came out of America. It was absolute nonsense.
Sure.
It's a beat up. They don't actually represent the view of even the conservative majority of Britain.
And and online, do you spend much time battling against this kind of person?
No, I quite some time ago disengaged with people talking about my stuff online, because especially this animated film of one of my slightly weird beat poems called Storm came out a few days ago. It was released onto YouTube and has sort of generated quite a lot of traffic, and it's a 10-minute rant about the things I rant about rationalism and stuff, and it's a piece that people really like, but the conversation in the comments, I mean, I have actually gone to look at that, which I is usually as a rule I don't do that, but because it's a film of a piece that I wrote some years ago, I feel less sort of worried about what people say. And it's just hilarious watching it descend so quickly into an argument between two sides that are so completely irreconcilably opposed. There's actually, the poem's got everything in it that I believe, and there's all these arguments about the same issues that I address in the poem, and they're not even listening to the text anymore. They're just talking at each other about how they're going to burn in hell, and it's just really, really weird. So I've stopped. I don't ever Google myself or read reviews or read comments on videos or anything. I've still got a bit of a Twitter habit.
That must take quite a lot of self-restraint for somebody in your position to never look at that stuff.
I think Twitter is dangerous, because you have this constant feed of people talking about you, and I've been developing this theory of why comedians and actors and stuff are the way they are, and I've named it acquired narcissistic personality disorder, because it really is, you just can feed on yourself. And it's taught to you by the industry and by the people who drive you around in cars and put you in nice hotels, and you learn to make your life more and more about yourself. And you constantly have to be resisting it if you want to have a normal life.
Yeah.
So I think I need to stop reading Twitter as well, because, 100 people say they really like me, and that's not particularly good for your sense of balance. And one person says they hate you, and you get into a strop,
Yeah.
And I'm not emotionally equipped to deal with people being awful about me in any scenario. I don't think most of us are.
Mm.
I'm still human enough to, if someone says you're not funny online, I go, what do you mean?
Yeah.
And so I learned that I'm not good at it. So I just don't. It's so much better not to. I never remember who the quote is. It might be Oscar Wilde, who said, "Other people's opinion of you is none of your business."
That was Jesus Christ.
Was it Jesus?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. Wrong queer.
He was asexual.
Yeah, exactly. He loved all men.
Yeah. So let's talk about the live dates. You're playing at the Royal Albert Hall in London.
Next weekend, yeah, on the day before and the day of the royal wedding. It's my alternative royal occasion on the 29th of April. And there's still tickets for the royal wedding night. I think Kate and Will are going to come. Everyone else is, they might as well. And then I pop over to New York to do some of these smaller gigs, and then I come back and do Sheffield and Liverpool and Glasgow again as a sort of reprise show of the one I've just done.
Sure, and people can find those dates in the usual ways. We don't need to tell people how to do that these days.
TimMinchin.com.
They know.
It's easy, I'm ubiquitous.
Well, thank you so much for coming and talking and playing for us. You are going to do another song, but we're not going to put it on the air because there's a certain nervousness amongst broadcasters about your material, I think is fair to say.
Yeah, broadcasters are funny about that.
Yeah.
It's almost like people don't find dead babies funny.
I'm going to stay silent on that through past experience.
Sure.
But we look forward to that. And for now, thank you very much. Let's hear it once more for Tim Minchin.
Thank you.